ओम ब्रह्म सत्यम शिवम सुंदरम श्रृण्वन्तु विश्वे अमृतस्य पुत्रा आयधमानिति प्राणितोस्तु वेदाहमेतं पुरुषमहान्तं आदित्यवर्णं तमसः परस्तात्। All men are essentially children of immortality. They belong to the kingdom of heaven. Beyond the realm of darkness, there is one supreme truth which is self-shining like the sun. I shall read a poem of meditation from my Rhythm of Truth. May our whole life be unto thee a supreme act of self-offering. As the burning flame gives out light through continuous self-consuming. May all our actions be performed for the sake of thy glory. May all our thoughts be centered on thy ultimate victory. May all our feelings and impulses, desires and wishful thinking be swallowed up entire and transformed into one Godward yearning. I am going to speak this morning on how to transform the ego. As we all know, ego is a fundamental problem of human life insofar as our striving for spiritual growth and perfection is concerned. As all great teachers and masters have warned, have pointed out, that one single stupendous stumbling block to the flowering of the spiritual potential in man is this ego. So I would like to clarify this, because from this kind of warning which you come across in all religious books, ethical books, we so often draw a wrong conclusion. You see, here is what is called the tyranny of words. You know, words are intended to convey, to communicate truth. But oftener than not, because of what is called today the semantic problem, the problem in linguistic communication. You see, instead of communicating truth, so often it misleads to falsehood in all kinds of different ways. There are all kinds of tricks that language plays upon the human mind. These are the tricks of Maya. These are called in Indian philosophy the tricks of Maya. So this is a very important thing. If a great truth is properly understood, it is a divine blessing. See, it can lift us immediately into a higher level of consciousness. If it is misunderstood, misconstrued, misinterpreted, then it can confuse us, bewilder us, drive us into all kinds of wrong, dark, violence and bypass, blind alleys. So this is the problem of all problems in human life, actually. You see, the problem of all problems, this problem of communication, proper understanding. See, this is why, you know, a widespread practice in ancient times in India you will find is that the guru, the teacher, would never tell the disciple the truth until he is prepared. I'm sure you have heard about it. But why? Many have wondered, why is it? Are they kind of selfish? That they don't want to give the truth? Try to hold it to themselves as long as they can? Is that the idea? No. You see, the idea is that until and unless the mind is purified, until and unless our cognitive apparatus, the ability to know, to understand, and to apply properly. So until that has been purified and perfected, you see, however lofty a truth one can be told, instead of helping him, it can harm. That is why there is also the saying, never cast pearls before the swine. And that's the idea here. That there has to be fitness, self-training toward proper receptivity before an individual is in a position to understand, to receive, and to make constructive use of a great truth. That is the meaning of what is called brahmacharya in Indian yoga system. Self-preparation through self-discipline, self-purification. Because until that is achieved, there can never be proper comprehension of truth and the ultimate meaning of life. So that is an axiomatic truth. So therefore, I am saying all this because I know how on this point especially, you see, this the principle of ego. How on this point that is very widespread misunderstanding. And this has become especially important today, that because of the widespread misunderstanding, misapplication of a fundamental concept, the concept of the ego in human life, how great truths have produced sufferings in human life. You see. What I'm dealing with is a matter of very of great practical importance in our life. For example, you are wondering what I'm referring to. For example, the whole modern discovery of psychotherapy, psychoanalysis, psychology, you see, is just that. That mankind has been taught some very wonderful truths, spiritual truths, religious truths, ethical truths, throughout the ages. But on account of lack of proper understanding, on the contrary, misconstruction, these truths have caused a lot of immense suffering in human life in the form of neurotic problems, psychotic problems, all kinds of mental disturbance, all kinds of perversions of character have resulted from misunderstanding and misapplication of fundamental truths of life. As I said, I began by saying that all great teachers have warned that one should be careful of the ego problem and should overcome it, because it is by solving the ego problem, it is by conquering, subduing the ego that one realizes the true self or the spirit in man or the indwelling divine presence in the human heart, because this is the one stumbling block. So from that, many have drawn a negative conclusion. You see, that if ego is the arch enemy, if it is the number one enemy of God, that we have certainly to destroy it, kill it. And it is by destroying the ego alone that we can realize God or the Spirit, you see, which is a wrong conclusion. You see? So this is what I shall try to bring out. I shall tell you a little about the different forms in which the ego has manifested itself. But I shall at the same time tell you that it is not by destroying the ego but it is by transforming these that we solve our problem. Not destruction, but transformation. Not suppression, but sublimation. That is the key concept, the great fall. That is why the title is How to Transform the Ego, not How to Destroy the Ego. Because when we destroy the ego, then exactly the opposite effect is produced. Destruction of the ego means destruction of the self. Ego is the seed of the self. So destruction of the ego means destruction of the self. That is why when in an individual the ego is really destroyed, he goes to the mental hospital. He becomes incapacitated for living in society, to live his own life anymore, because he has lost his ownness. How can he live his own life when the very source of oneness is destroyed? So you can see the absurdity of that. So to repeat, truly speaking, ego is the seed of the self, true self in man. It is right in the very interior of the ego. You see, inside the husk, that the kernel of man's spiritual potential lies hidden. You know, we are all familiar with the saying that God is, kingdom of heaven is within. God is present in man, in every human being. So from the standpoint of my discussion today, I may say that just as God in his essential structure is a trinity, God as he indwells in man is also a trinity. And from the psychological standpoint, what is that trinity of the indwelling divine presence in human personality? It is the trinity of the ego, the superego, and the fire. You know, may sound strange. That is how it is present. That is how the spiritual potential is present in man. The ego, the superego, and the fire. The Sanskrit names for these are Manu, Indra, and Agni. Those of you who are familiar with Sanskrit language will remember that Agni means fire. Fire. He's a great god. And Indra is the lord of the supernatural kingdom. You see, he's present in all of us too. That is superego. You see, super. So, lord of the supernal world. Supernatural, supernal. So, that is Indra. And Manu. Manu is the mental principle. That is the mental ego, our normal ego. Manu, mental principle. Principle of mental self-consciousness, which also, you see, when you get to think about it, this mental self-consciousness is the prerogative of man, very distinctive feature of man. It is the self-consciousness which makes man what he is, because it is the reflection in man of the pure light of consciousness in the Supreme Being. Supreme Being is pure consciousness. The light, untellable light, the master light that lights up all other lights. That is the pure light of consciousness, the Supreme Being. Tat Shubhram Jyotisham Jyoti, as it has been described in the Upanishad. That Supreme Light, which is the essence of God or being, is Tat Shubhram Jyotisham Jyoti, is the white radiance of eternity, which shines as the light of all lights. Now, the ego, the Manu, the self-conscious, the spark of self-consciousness in man, is the reflection in imperfect human nature of that pure light and radiance of eternity. So that is a great prerogative. Don't destroy it. cultivate it, transform it more and more. See? So this is the great principle of self-development. So I shall now, with this introductory remark, I shall tell you, you know, in both Eastern and Western mythological, you know, stories, all the different kinds of manifestation of the ego principle have been described, but we do not recognize these always, you see, because these are in the form of stories and myths and legends and all that, you see, so we do not recognize. But there are all the different forms of manifestation of this ego principle, which is, what kind of principle is? Is the divine and divine principle. Is the God-demon principle. Duality. Is the duality. God-demon. If we cultivate properly, it becomes the divine power. If we don't understand what it is, abuse it, it becomes an undivine demonic power. Same thing. So divine, undivine principle. So this is a very important thing. It is the angelic demonic power. If we know what it is, then it becomes angelic. If we don't know what it is, then it becomes demonic. So it is the hydra-headed dragon, you know. Has many forms. Good forms and bad forms. So I think it might be nice to give you an idea of the different forms of manifestation of this ego principle in man. Then I shall show how this can be, you know, end with a positive note of telling, bringing out how it can be transformed with the help of the other two powers I have just now mentioned, namely Indra and Agni. Now, beginning on the lower, from the bottom, one is called tamasic ego, ego which is darkened with ignorance, is tamasic ego. And what is that tamasic ego? The tamasic ego is the ignorant ego, the darkened ego, which assumes such forms as, oh, I am no good. I am not able to do anything. This is this kind of depressed ego, deflated ego. Or the ego that says, that also is ego, you know, I. The ego which says, oh, I am very sinful. Very sinful, hopeless, unredeemable. So that, in such a condition that even when God appears in disguise to help, he refuses. It is no use trying to help. That's how he feels. You see? So, you see, this is the depressed ego, tamasic ego. It is so depressed that it closes the door of its own transformation, uplift. So this is dark ignorance, you see. So, you see, a principle of transformation is, in yoga psychology, yoga discipline, that the dark ego has to be liberated with the sharp sword, you see, with the sharp sword of the bright ego, rajas ego, opposite, its opposite. You see, you conquer, overcome something with its opposite. So when the ego is in a very dark, deflated condition, then it is good to think of just the opposite, see, opposite possibilities of life. That is the time when one has to think of, very uplifting goals, ambition, higher ambitions. That is the time when other people who want to help talk of the possibilities of enjoyment, prosperity, wealth and power, all these things become, you know, necessary to lift you. All the hidden desires of the human heart, it becomes. So this is the technique of, you see, uplifting a person in depressed condition with the opposite rajasic ideas. That is where we find that in Chandi, which is one of the very interesting, you know, you are all more or less familiar with the Bhagavad Gita, which is a wonderful book called the Song of God, Celestial Song, which is very universally used, you know, in India by all spiritual seekers. As a matter of fact, all the leaders of the modern spiritual renaissance of India used Bhagavad Gita as a source of inspiration. As you know that Gandhi, in carrying on the freedom movement on a spiritual basis, used two books always. One is Bhagavad Gita in one hand, and the other is Sermon on the Mount in another hand. So these were the sources of inspiration to him. But there is another very, very important spiritual book which is not much known, which is called Chandi, C-H-A-N-D-I, which is also very widespread, even though it is not yet much known in this country yet, which is used as a must, as a must reading in every great religious festival, in every important religious festival. That is called Chandi, which is a very positive, affirmative approach to life. So you will find in Chandi how there is the emphasis upon the positive forces in our life, positive desires, which should be and can be properly mobilized in order to lift a man out of his low condition, to inspire him. So there is mention of, you know, goddess of wealth and prosperity, goddess of beauty and enjoyment and harmony. You see, the idea being that even these things are great values in life and have proper place, function in our spiritual growth. It's a very positive thing. Recognition there is that everything that you find within yourself, you see, is a divine gift or a gift of Mother Nature in whatever way you put it, you see. And therefore, everything has its proper place and function in the total scheme of self-development. So it is foolish for us, you see, to take a negative attitude to any of the basic principles of life and try to destroy it or suppress it. You see, the suppression policy is very dangerous and detrimental. That is the one great lesson of modern discoveries in psychology and philosophy. Let me proceed further. So one form of manifestation of yoga is that very deflated condition of the ego. The another form of manifestation is what is called kapurush ego, you see, very fearful ego. The first one is, as I say, very sinful thinking ego. The other one is kapurush ego, fearful ego. Ego, I mean the individual who is full of fear and anxiety, in constant fear. Of fear, anxiety. Anxiety of all kinds. You know, Paul Tillich has written a wonderful book called Courage to Be. That's the name of the book. Courage to Be. You know, Paul Tillich, the modern theologian, existential theologian. There he talks about different kinds of anxiety that people have and how these anxieties and fears make their life miserable. As a matter of fact, today, that is the big problem. You see, most of anything else, you see, this anxiety here is the most pervasive, the problem of human life. That is why this has been described by some psychologists as the age of anxiety. We live in an age of anxiety for many reasons. For 100 reasons, you see. Most important of these reasons is, you see, the accentuation of the sense of insecurity in today's world. One reason, you see, sense of insecurity. Huh? People talk of the atomic bomb. Huh? People talk of a third world war. You see, so all that is there. Then we hear about this dangerous overpopulation, ecological crisis, all kinds of crises. No wonder there will be anxiety. You see? And on the top of this all, so on the top of this all, that is what is called existential anxiety. You see? Which is very, very subtle. Existential anxiety. That is to say, anxiety of death, you see, which is secretly present. Death and powerlessness. You see the feeling. This feeling that we are finite, we are imperfect, and we are powerless and helpless is always there, deep down in our heart. You see, so long what happened throughout the ages before, religious faith, spiritual faith, the flame of spiritual aspiration in the human soul helped us in conquering this existential anxiety. But now that is gone. You see, as a result of the technological character, the technological structure of modern civilization, the spiritual means of subduing existential anxiety is gone. So therefore, it has become very much accentuated. Which means that we have got to discover, replace the ancient, the old gods that have died with new god. See, that is the great need of the present age. You know, Martin Heidegger one time said that at the close of every age or epoch of history, old gods die. But then at the beginning of every new age, new gods are reincarnated or incarnated. In whatever you put it. You see, new gods are incarnate. And that is the kind of transition period through which we are going today. Old gods are died, have died, and this was proclaimed with all solemnity by the philosopher Nietzsche when he just said, God is dead. You see. And we are groping toward the discovery of new gods, the god of the new age, the avatar of the new age. And we have still to clearly see that and understand what that is. You see? So this is the transition period in which we are living. Because that alone can solve this basic problem of existential anxiety and serve as a new source of creative inspiration in human life. All right. So that is called kapurusha. Kapurusha. Ego. I mean fearful, anxiety-ridden ego. Then that is called Kuberic ego. You need not write those things. Maybe just write the English points. Kuberic ego. You see, which is, you know, when we lose this sense of spiritual value in life, then our source of security, main source, or even only source of security becomes material thing, material possession. And the more we have bank balance, the more we feel secure. The more we have possession, the more we feel secure. The more we have different things and objects around us, the more we feel secure. So this is the Kuberic ego, exploitative ego. We exploit and we grab. We want to grab things. The more we succeed in grabbing, the more we feel happy. So this is another form of manifestation. Then, very similar to that, is Gandharva ego, hedonic ego, Epicurean ego. Eat, drink, and be merry. Make hay while the sun shines. The principles. You see, when there is an absence of, total absence of spiritual joy, you know, the joy of the spirit, intrinsic joy of the spirit, when there is a vacuum, a void, an emptiness in the heart, you see. Then we try to fill that emptiness more and more, you see, with all kinds of pleasures that we can accumulate from the outside. So this becomes, therefore, the lifestyle. And when external pleasures appear also, when we come to a point that even the external normal sources of pleasure become boring. That also happens in human life. You see? Because when we overemphasize external pleasure, then pretty soon we come to the saturation point and we become bored. see. When that happens, then, you see, what is the source of pleasure anymore? Drug becomes source of pleasure. Cake. Either drug or destructiveness, you see. Now, this is psychology. You see, this is the psychological principle. You see, when you lose all or completely close all inner sources of joy and bliss and happiness and peace, and you become completely extroverted in search for happiness, joy, pleasure. You see, first of all, it is the objects, different objects of enjoyment. But then, if we overemphasize these external objects of enjoyment, then we are led to what is called saturation point and come to a kind of sort of boredom. This is called by philosophers paradox of hedonism. I don't know whether you have heard that expression. Have you? Anybody? Eh? Paradox of hedonism. Eh? You see, this is a philosophical, you know, doctrine. Paradox of hedonism means that if we are consciously always searching for pleasure, then pleasure eludes our grasp. It is like a will-o'-the-wisp. You see, if you deliberately always are seeking pleasure, then pleasure eludes your grasp. You don't see it. It is like running after the horizon. You see, chasing after butterflies or flyway. You don't get it. You see, why? Because according to the very law of psychology, our keenest pleasures and joys are those that come unexpected. You see, you remember your own life, you know, look back and you try to remember. You will see that the keenest joys and pleasures in your life have been those which came to you unexpected, when you are not specially striving for them. If you strive for it, you don't have that kind of pleasure. You see? Why? Because the law of pleasure is that pleasure is not a positive, you see, content of the mind. You know, it is a subtle psychological point here. That pleasure is not a content of the mind. Pleasure is a byproduct of the satisfaction of our goal, fulfillment of our goal. When you have a purpose or goal, you see, some value in front of us, some value that we appreciate, that we really think great. You see, when we have a sense of value, and that value is satisfied in us, fulfilled in us, we gain that objective, then we have immense joy. So you see, it is not something to search for. You don't search for pleasure, no. Then you don't ever get pleasure. You search for value, something good, something beautiful, something true. That is what you search for. In proportion to your success and ability to achieve that goal, whether true or beauty or good, you have immense joy. So it is a byproduct, not an objective or goal in life. So this is why there is paradox of hedonism. Deliberate search for pleasure is a wild goose chase, bound to be. It is condemned to be self-defeating. Then that is what is called pishachik type of ego. You see, pishachik, that means very lethargic, very idle, lethargic type of ego. You see, the ego that is dominated by the law of inertia. You see, so this is called pishachik. And those who are, for example, there are some who are very always procrastinating. You see, don't want to take up anything, you know, always trying to shirk responsibility. Don't want to undertake anything, which will mean responsibility. Or don't want to exert. Even in religious, even in spiritual life, in yoga I have seen that some people find all kinds of excuses, you know, for shirking responsibility. They know that, well, it is good, you know, they have accepted a spiritual ideal of life, and they know that to go through self-discipline, to study or to meditate or to think is very good. So they have come to the spiritual path. And pretty soon they also find out, it has been said in the scriptures, that you are one with the Supreme, you see. And because of this this tendency to follow inertia, they draw immediately wrong conclusion. Then they will deceive themselves by saying, or self-deluded into the belief that, well, wonderful, if I am already one with God, with the Supreme Being, then what is the use of all this fuss of going through meditation and self-discipline and all that? I'm already one. That's how they delude themselves, you see. And therefore again decide, come back to the normal, you see. Come back to the normal and decide not to do anything about it because they have already gone there. So I remember there is one of the modern yoga teachers in India has written in the book with regard to this particular tendency of the human mind. And I think this is a good story illustrating the point I feel like telling you. That, there was a very young boy who became orphaned. And therefore, he had to be taken to an orphanage. And he was growing up in an orphanage, but had lots of fear, anxiety, this depression, inferiority, or being neglected, or having lost moorings, you see, was growing. Now it so happened that in a foreign country, his uncle, who was a very successful businessman, he died, but then he left a great fortune just in the name of this young boy. But he did not know it. Nobody knew it at that time, until after a period of time. So even though he had a great fortune in store for him, he was growing up in suffering, mental anguish. So after a few years, suddenly one day, the news came to him. The news came that his uncle left for him a great fortune, to such and such, handsome bank balance, you see, in a Bank of London, you see. So, try to think of that situation. He is a rich man, already a rich man, but the thing is he already? I want you to think of that, you see. In a sense, he is a rich man and already a rich man. He has a huge amount of money in the bank, in his account, in his name. So he is and he is not a super rich man just at that time. You see, potentially he is. But he has got to actualize that potentiality. And that is a lot of doing that is necessary to actualize that potentiality, is it not? Potentially, he's a very rich man. But then, after having come to know about it, he has to do certain things. You see, he has to take the necessary steps to make himself known, to prove his identity, and to contact the right sources, and to have access, real access, to all that money which belongs to him. Then he can use it. So long as he cannot use it, he is not. So this is the human condition. That is the great divine or spiritual potentiality, dormant in human personality. So we are, in a sense, one with the Supreme. Potentiality for oneness is there. But so long as we don't do anything by of actualizing that potentiality, we are nothing. So we are both one with God and not one with God. It all depends upon how we understand it. Anyway, so this is therefore, another variety of pisachic form is extreme lethargy. How lethargic, I tell you, people can sometimes be There were two friends who were very notorious for their idleness and procrastination. And one time they were resting and relaxing, you know, just lying together in a cot. Suddenly, the house caught fire. And pretty soon, there was fire around. And different things were burning. But they were relaxing, you know, in great delight. One of them felt the fire in the back. And he just briefly, you know, a very idle man does not even want to spend much energy by talking too much, you see. So he just say, BB, which is supposed to be understood as meaning back burns. And the other one also replied very laconically, very briefly, by saying TA means turn around. That was his solution. I have a few things, so I shall just rapidly go through. One is called rakshasik type, that is the destructive type. One has become, you know, antisocial, destructive impulse comes to the front, and this is the destructive type. Then there is the Promethean type, you know, Prometheus, as you know, stole fire from heaven. You see. So, which is, we come to fire here, you see. He stole fire. You see. And so gods were afraid. You see, because possession of fire is good, fire is a wonderful thing. But gods were afraid. Why? Because gods were afraid for this reason, that human beings as they are, you never know how they are going to use that fire. That's why. When I first came across this Greek legend, I was surprised that Prometheus did such a good thing. He brought fire from heaven, and that was very good. So how come gods seem to be very jealous? Why are they angry about it? Why do they want to punish Prometheus? You see. So that's how I reacted when I first came across, you see, this legend. But now I see the point that fire is a great potential, great blessing, you see. That is how civilization began, as you know. It was man's discovery of fire that started human civilization. But also, as we know, that was the beginning of a lot of human, you know, destruction. War and all that. Healing of thousands upon thousands of people through armed hostility, antagonism, conflict. So that which is a blessing can also become a curse, you see, because of human stupidity and ignorance and selfishness. That is why they alarm. Otherwise, by itself, it is fine. So Promethean type, therefore, is that, that has that heroic strength, extraordinary ability to discover power, just as modern Prometheans. Modern Prometheans have discovered atomic energy. That's wonderful. You see, there is a book of this name, you know, The New Prometheans, the book on modern science. So this is wonderful, but at the same time, therein also lies the great danger. The great threat to civilization today comes from that source. So then there is Asuric ego. You see, Asuric ego. Asuric ego is A-S-U-R-I-C. You know, this is Sri Aurobindo has written a good deal about these things, you know, in his different book, when he has discussed the forces of darkness that hinder human progress, spiritual and otherwise. You see, he has discussed some of these, you know, problems, forces of darkness and hostility. So, Asuric Shakti, Asuric Ego, A-S-U-R-I-C. is that kind of opposition, force of opposition, or, you see, that kind of ego, which is, if I may use this expression, which is ideologically inflated. You know, ideologically inflated. In other words, it finds, just as Prometheus finds fire and thinks that that is going to be the solution to all problems, you see, which it is not. So, Asura is that which discovers spiritual, ideological fire, an idea, great idea, a great intellectual principle, or a great system, and thinks that that's all that is needed, that is going to solve all problems. So that is Asuri. That is part of our present problem. That has been the problem since the days of, you see, Inquisition, religious warfare, Holy Crusade, and today ideological warfare. You see. That is the problem. Asuric ego. Asuric ego is at the root is the root cause of this problem of human civilization. in a small way, all of us have this tendency, you know, when you find a very good idea, good principle, good ethical doctrine, good religious creed, then we are inclined to think that is going to solve all problems. We absolutize it. This is this tendency to deify a particular principle, creed, article of faith, ideology, system of thought, you see, as the ultimate, as the panacea of all evils, all ills. So that is actually, this is due to our human ignorance too. Nothing can take the place of God. God alone is God. No idea, no creed can take the place of God. You see? This is why Martin Heidegger very briefly summed it all up by saying that the time has come for realize that God is God. Period. Wonderful. He says, he did not use God, he says B, capital B. He says, the time has come for us to realize being is, period. That means, don't identify being with anything else. Nothing can take its place. Being is. Being is being. Om Tat Sat, as Upanishad says. Om Tat Sat, that being, period. Don't identify. Don't indulge in false identification. God is not to be identified with anything else, whether an idea or a creed or an article of faith or a scientific law or an ethical principle or a system, nothing, or a machine, nothing. God is God. So this is the supreme wisdom, you see. This is the supreme spiritual wisdom, realization of the fact that God knows no substitute. God alone is God. Being alone is being. Truth alone is truth, as Gandhi emphasized. Truth alone is truth. Don't identify with any particular creed or ideology. Okay, so this is, finally, let me conclude by saying that you see, at the heart of, you know, in the heart of all of this, you see, this positive nucleus, this profound spiritual potential of man, ego in its spiritual essence, which it is our task more and more to develop, to cultivate, to nourish, to bring to flowering. You see, this is what we may call the divine spark, this spark of self-consciousness in man. You see, inside the shell of the ego, that is this hidden spark of self-consciousness in man. So this has been called in Indian mythology, Vaman, the dwarf, dwarfish light. You see, that which is very dwarf, very small. So the name for that is Vaman, Vaman means dwarf. You see, so I shall tell you a story. You know, Walt Whitman in his Leaves of Grass has referred to this word, Vamon, dwarfish light. Very interesting. And all those who meditate and make a progress in spiritual life experience it. This is what St. Paul called the imperishable spark of the divine in man. But that imperishable spark is hidden right there inside our ego consciousness. Let me tell you this story. There was a great king, Bali, who was very fabulously wealthy and immensely powerful. And he was also very righteous. Very righteous person. It is because he was very righteous that he became very wealthy and powerful. But with all that, he did not believe in God, however. He was an atheist or an agnostic, if you may say. So for him, Krishna or Vishnu, God of love, that was worshipped by his people. He was very hateful of that. He very much disliked this, that instead of worshipping him, they worship Vishnu, the god of love. You see? And he also used to wonder, why do they do so? Am I not the one who can give them food and shelter? Why do they worship God? So he used often to wonder. But however, he was a very righteous person, you see. He was compassionate and tried his best to help people. So this is very interesting, you know, interesting story, plot. So one time, he had a very big socio-religious festival, which is not, from the standpoint of people, it was religious. He did not believe in religion. So it was a kind of, really for him, socio-political festival. In which different people all were invited, all were welcome. And whoever would come would receive gift from the king. I mean, that was the festival. So you would receive gift. Nobody would go back from the festival empty-handed. So many, many people came. High and mighty. Rich and poor came. Because even the rich people have something they can get from the emperor, you see. So it was a vast gathering. Suddenly, in the midst of all this, you know, merriment which was going on in this vast congregation, suddenly from a distance was to be seen a very tiny figure, you know, a very small dwarfish kind of person coming. His name is Vamon. So first of all, people did not pay any attention to me. Who is this fellow coming? You know, very, very, almost invisible. In that vast gathering. But as they happened to have a close look, they were a little astonished, you know, taken aback, because he was very effulgent kind, you know, very luminous figure, small, but luminous. So he did not, however, pay attention to anything or anybody. He was cutting his way through this crowd and went right in front of the king, you see. The king, first of all, was surprised to see the audacity of this fellow who came, you know, cutting through the crowd right in front of him. But when he had a second look, he was astonished too, because he was radiating light, his figure. So he therefore welcomed him and gave him a seat, and then said, "What can I do for you?" And then you see in his exuberance, he said, "Well, I shall be very happy to give you whatever you wish. So just ask a boon to me." You know, in those days that was also customary. So when a distinguished guest comes, a king or somebody in power and position is supposed to give, fulfill a boon. So he says, "Make your wish, I shall fulfill it." He says, "Whatever you want." So in response to that, Vamon said, "My lord, I don't have much to ask. All that I want is 3 stripes of land in your kingdom." You know, 3 stripes of land. That means land that you can get by 3 steps. three steps of land. But king was just surprised. He says, what do you mean, three strides of land? Just ask for me, ask a whole island I shall give you, a whole province I shall give you. What is this, three strips of land? Because especially for a Brahmin dwarf, you know, what would that amount to? Nothing. See? So king, said that. And just at that time, the family preceptor of the king came from inside, Bihaspati his name, and he heard the conversation. And they, he understood the significance of what was going on, you see. So he turned to the king and he said, you know, you have made a blunder. What have you done? You have promised to give him three steps of land. He will take everything you have. Nothing will be left to you. So withdraw, immediately withdraw your promise. The king said, no, I cannot do that. Because I am a man of word, and in my whole family background, there has been no king who has ever violated his own promise or word. So I cannot do that. So Brihaspati tried to, this is a very beautiful conversation they had in the book, Brihaspati tried to convince him how on some special circumstances it is all right to tell a white lie. You see, just as, Plato talks about noble lies, so Brihaspati was telling him, a man of wisdom he was, so tell him that how on special circumstances, for example, in self-defense, a person can tell a lie, he said. Then in the defense of one's family or country, a person can tell a lie, you see. So especially three occasions, you see. And then also, in order to, preserve his love affair, a person can tell a lie, you see. So, the king was unconvinced. He says, no, I have given my royal word, and I have got to keep it. So, turning to Brahman, he said, well, I have given you, made a promise. Would you kindly proceed to take your land? It's all right. Fine. So in the twinkling of an eye, he was expanding. He was a tiny light. He was expanding. And then with just one step, he took the whole earth and expanded. With another step, he took the whole heaven. Now he turns to the king, where shall I keep my third step? No place left. So now king realized the situation. Then he offered his head. He said, please keep your third step on my head. He was transformed. This is transformation. So this is the Brahman, is the light. You see, divine spark that shines in the depth of our being, which is capable of expansion. This is what spirituality is all about. Meditation, spirituality, yoga, religion is all about. More and more bringing about the expansion of the imperishable spark of the divine that shines in the depth of man. And that is how all hostile forces are eventually conquered. You see, the king was the ego. You see, the king represents the big ego, the giant ego. You see. And this spark is something that belongs within. You see, he was even part of the king. See, he did not know it. So eventually, the ego was conquered. So we see here the transformation. Because the king eventually, he forgot his hostility, his antagonism. You see, he offered his head for the third step. He kept his promise. So this is the secret of transformation of the ego, which is an essential condition of spiritual fulfillment or becoming one with the Supreme Being. Thank you. Now I shall ask Yashoda to play piano and a love offering will be taken. Now let us meditate for a few minutes. Relax and let go. Establish silence in your being. And concentrate on the inner light that shines in the heart of man. It is the light of pure consciousness, which is the inmost essence of our being. The more you concentrate on the inner light, the more it permeates your whole being, purifies the total nature, and unites the individual self with the universal spirit. As different ideas and feelings, sensations, and memories come into the mind, let all these be consigned to the inner flame of consciousness. It is the inner light which has been called consciousness of our consciousness, being of our being, existence of our existence, the self of our self. Union with the inner light is the source of revitalization and new inspiration and illumine creativity in life. Shanti, shanti, shanti. Om shanti, shanti, shanti. Om shanti, shanti, shanti.